In today's lecture, that is the 17th lecture, we are going to continue our discussion on feedback amplifier and its application. However, we will be first concentrating on active device, which is just a simple single transistor and corresponding feedback amplifiers. The advantage of such a circuit is that in the present day VLSI, the design should be rugged, should work under all conditions without any problem or for need, without any need for any adjustment later. So, in the present day VLSI, only single transistor active device is used in feedback, and then that local feedback circuit is cascaded with similar such single transistor circuits to form any complex amplifier. Like single transistor circuit, we have already discussed in the last class at the end of the lecture, as transconductor amplifier and trans resistance amplifier. Coupling this together, putting transconductor first and transresistor later, you can design a voltage controlled voltage source or voltage amplifier, and putting a transresistor first and then a transconductor, you can design a current controlled current source. So, all the four amplifiers can be designed with local feedback for the active device, and that is best suited and the most rugged feedback amplifier ever. Using more number of active devices in cascade is beset with problems of instability because of the fact that a single transistor naturally involves two time constants minimum, and one at the input, one at the output. Whereas, if you cascade two transistors together, it will increase the order minimum 2, 3, one at the input, one at the output, one intermediate. The moment it becomes a third order system, we have seen that the system with feedback is likely to become unstable, particularly at high frequencies. Now, let us continue with that, and today we will be discussing first that how to convert these feedback amplifier structures to one that is suitable for IC. So, biasing strategy that we have to adopt, and how to improve the signal to noise ratio in the IC that has been designed. This is the primary objective, and in that exercise we will show how systematically any single input single output stage can be converted to differential input and differential output in order to facilitate signal coming as differential and noise coming as common mode. Normally noise gets transmitted through power line, and therefore power line voltage or power line derived current, which is required for biasing, is always connected as common mode to this symmetric structure. So, how systematically we can arrive at a symmetric structure which is going to be differential input and differential output. That is the strategy, and further we will migrate over to application of op-amp circuits in terms of instrumentation amplifier design, and perhaps conclude in that particular topic for today. Let us see how we are going to now discuss the transistor IC design, starting from basic. So, these were the last two circuits that were designed in the last lecture, design of trans impedance amplifier. You can see the single MOSFET or bipolar transistor for that matter is used in feedback with this as the feedback network. This is the source admittance, this is the load admittance, and this is the equivalent circuit of our active device, which is delta VGS getting converted as GM into delta VGS with the shunt admittance GDS. So we have seen how this is Y feedback, and therefore Y parameters get added of the feedback network and the amplifier network, including source and load, and then how we have to invert it and get the Z matrix. Ultimately, if GM is made much greater than any of the G's that are present in this, then all the other parameters go towards 0 Z parameters, and this transfer parameter alone becomes independent of the active device and is equal to minus RF. That is how we get the transimpedance amplifier design. A transresistance amplifier was then considered using for example MOSFET or bipolar as the active device, then this is the leakage resistance at the input if it is existing, and this is the feedback resistance RF linking the input with the output, and this is the load. And now the Z parameters add, this is called Z feedback, and Y matrix is what we desire, and we see that the matrix now is dependent upon GM. It is going to be very large if GM is very large. So then all the other parameters, Y parameters, go to 0 except for the transfer parameter, which is going to depend only on the RF, 1 over RF. Now we start with, therefore, let us say either bipolar transconductance amplifier as depicted earlier or MOS transconductance amplifier, and get its Y matrix ideal amplifier as above, and then using bipolar or MOS transresistance amplifiers and transconductance amplifiers, we can design all the other 4 types of amplifiers. Okay, so now how to obtain a bipolar differential transconductance amplifier is going to be illustrated. You just take 2 single ended transconductors to form a differential structure. That is, a differential transconductance amplifier is to be designed. So the procedure is, this is the single stage transconductor using bipolar transistor. It can be a MOS also. We are taking for example a bipolar stage, so that we end up with a bipolar structure for the transconductor. If you want to have a MOS stage, you take the corresponding MOS transconductance amplifier with the ideal matrix as shown. Now transresistance amplifier is basically this, this structure with feedback forming the transresistance. And II comes here, II into RF flows here, and the voltage appears as minus II into RF. In the previous one, when VI is applied here, VI by RF, VI into GF current flows through this, that current is same as this current. So that is how the transfer parameter is GF. Now this is input is a nullator. Here, because the input is a nullator here, this VI appears directly across this. It does not draw any current. Here it appears as a short circuit at the input. Now let us say we have obtained such a transconductor, okay, and how to bias it now. So base to emitter junction has to be forward bias, because it is N type of NPN transistor or N channel MOSFET. So we apply common mode voltage correspondingly, which is okay, let's say such that this particular junction gets forward biased, and the current will be accordingly determined as this voltage is roughly V gamma, Vc plus Vd by 2 minus V gamma, okay, plus Vs by Rs is the current flowing through this. So that current is going to be flowing almost here also, and therefore we have fixed this potential such that base collector potential, that is collector base potential, is having a positive voltage so that it is reverse biased. So identical structure is drawn, okay, here, so that base collector potential, collector base potential is positive so that it is reverse biased, base emitter potential is negative, base emitter potential is also positive here, so that this is forward biased. So the transistor action takes place, so we can assume it as nullator at the input and this current is nearly same as this current. So this is a nice way of biasing, but you can see that we are connecting the load resistance to VDD in order to facilitate higher potential than the base potential to occur here. So the operating point should be decided appropriately so that there is a forward, that is a drop which is positive from here to here. Okay. Now this is a symmetric structure. Now such a symmetric structure can be just converted into a very simple differential structure by connecting a resistance between these two emitters which is twice RS. So what happens in such a situation is that if you put RS and RS here to these two emitters, let us say this is E1, this is E2. So this becomes a symmetric structure, and this common mode point here, okay, this is the common mode point, okay. For differential signals, the change in potential here is going to be 0 at all times. Whatever be the differential signal here, if this is Vd by 2 and this is minus Vd by 2, okay, whatever be the value of Vd, this potential keeps remaining at all times at 0. So you can either ground it or connect it through a current source. It does not make any difference as far as the differential signal is concerned. So we decide to use, okay, let us say a current source here. This is also equivalent to a symmetric structure which is twice RS, and if this is, let us say, twice I0, right, you can split that I0 into I0 and I0 here and form the same differential structure. So now this can be connected to some potential, it is of no consequence as far as the differential mode operation is concerned. So only in the common mode we have this current, okay, flowing through these resistances and developing a DC potential. That DC drop is totally unnecessary, right, to be incurred, okay, and therefore we can just split it into two equivalent circuits, two current sources I0 and I0, and still retain the symmetry, and that is the strategy adopted. Then actually in this there will be only the differential mode signal that is going to carry current, okay, and therefore the common mode current which has been already split as I0 and I0, it will flow through the individual transistors. That is going to bias these two transistors appropriately, okay, forward bias these two transistors. So please understand that the nullator at the emitter point, you have to have the current source, okay, biasing, so that collector current is equal to emitter current, okay, I0. So we have this I0 flowing here, okay, this I0 is flowing here, okay. Through this, whatever flows is going to be, now you can see this is going to be just the differential signal, because this is as far as the signal is concerned 0 drop, so, and this also is 0 drop nullator. So this is going to be Vd divided by twice RS current. So the total current in this is I0 plus, okay, Vd by 2 RS, okay, and this will be I0 minus Vd by 2 RS. So that will be the current flowing in this. So the output will be having only the common mode drop, which is VDD minus I naught RL here, VDD minus I naught RL here, that is the common mode voltage, okay, and that can be set by proper selection of I naught. So that this junction is reverse biased, that is a positive voltage here. So this is the universal method of IC design, okay, wherein we lift the emitter point, okay, which is common mode, okay, through a current source, okay, and then split the current into two identical ones. So there is no need for a DC drop unnecessarily getting wasted in RS, okay, and therefore minus VSS can be now of a lower value than before, okay. So this is the way we have arrived at IC transconductor, okay, and this current can get converted to voltage by RL and RL. So this VD by 2RS will flow to 2RL as the differential load and develop that times 2RL. VD by 2RS into 2RL is the output voltage, differential voltage of this structure. So this transconductor mainly is formulated by the transistors and this common resistor connecting the two transistors together, right. So this will carry only the signal which is differential signal. It has no component coming into picture in terms of the DC bias. So it is such a thing is possible only if there is perfect symmetry in terms of transistors being identical and the currents being identical, which is what is possible today in the present day technology, that you might be able to match these transistors and the current sources, okay, and those resistors better in IC design than in discrete design. So this nobody should therefore go for single ended structures which are outdated structures of today in the era of IC. All the analog front end must be made up of differential structure at the input, so that the common mode noise gets eliminated at the output. In this structure of two such symmetric things, what happens is the common mode component also produces current in the load, okay, whereas in this structure, okay, the common mode noise has no effect at the output, or the common mode gain of this ideal structure is 0. That means VC does not have any influence in producing any output at the load, whereas here two identical structures and subtracting this also will result in difference operation and you will get a differential signal, right, if they are identical. However, the common mode still appears, okay, as the output. So the common mode influence, if it is actually a common mode signal which is interfering, it is a nuisance, because the signal to noise ratio has not improved by using such a difference structure, whereas a differential structure improves the signal to noise ratio considerably, okay. So this is the main operation of converting every single input single output structure existing to differential input differential output suitable for IC design, particularly in the front end. Now let us do the same thing for the differential trans resistor. Now what is done is the same strategy, that this is the single structure. So I start with the single structure . Now I bias it suitably so that collector base junction is reverse biased. So this is connected to a positive potential and this might have to be connected to a negative potential, or yeah, this is the way. Now you repeat the same thing and cause a symmetry to exist. Then this is the common point. Instead of grounding it, I will lift it through a current source required for biasing, okay, and then you have the resultant differential transistor. Very simple. If this is twice I naught, this will be I naught and this will be I naught by symmetry. So you have biased it in a stable fashion without using any of those bypass capacitors and other things that may be required later in the discrete circuit design you have used it. And there is no need to start with the single ended structure at all that is meant for discrete circuit design, okay, in order to save in terms of the active devices. By using a differential structure like this, right, it has not only got rid of all these bypass capacitors etcetera and resulted in improvement in signal to noise ratio, improvement in performance in terms of drift voltage causing interference etcetera. So offset compensation also is going to occur this way. Therefore, these are the important building blocks of today in ICs. So what will be the thing? The differential current which is applied between these two terminals ID flows through RF, okay, and generates this minus 2 RF into ID as the voltage, differential voltage at the output. It is independent of the load resistance because it is a feedback structure that we had already shown. Now combining the differential transconductor, this is the differential transconductor. So we have the common mode voltage plus VDI by 2, common mode voltage minus VDI by 2, input common mode voltage can be anything, okay. So that the collector base is still reverse biased all the time when the signal also is there, that is the only condition, okay. And then it is cascaded to another structure, that is, what is this? This is the differential transistor to form what is called as differential voltage amplifier, differential input, differential output. The common mode output voltage is determined by primarily by I naught, okay, and some current that is going to flow through this, okay. So that is the differential voltage amplifier whose voltage gain is differential voltage gain VDO by VDI is twice RF divided by this R. It was earlier represented as twice RS, right. So it gives the same gain as the single ended ultimately, RF by RS, right, the load resistance by the total source resistance, right. So that is the feedback amplifier gain, okay. However, right, now it is biased automatically, properly. This current is chosen for giving you the required swing at the output, okay. This current is the one that determines the input impedance of this bipolar structure, right. So along with R, so 1 over gm of this gets added to R as this is not truly annihilator, 1 over gm of this also gets added to this. So effectively the R changes to R plus 2 over gm of the input transistors, that into beta plus 1, okay, is the input impedance of this structure. Output impedance is primarily determined by the shunt feedback at the output RF and the GM of this that we have already determined in the earlier feedback amplifier design course, okay, lecture. Now this is a commercial differential voltage amplifier or video amplifier for picture amplification video signal 733, still available with TI in the era of bipolar ICs, and this is an important structure. Using MOS you can replace all these transistors by MOS and the performance will be similar to that of this, except that GM of the MOS is an order of magnitude less than the GM of the corresponding equal sized bipolar. Okay. So, this bipolar structure is nearer ideal amplified for feedback than the MOS structures. However, MOS has become popular, okay, both in now analog and digital. The analog usage is because of the digital system covering most of the system on a chip, okay, processing activity. So, now this is the structure, which is the transconductor here. You can see the transconductor is having a load of 2.4 k. That is of no consequence because this input stage acts as a short circuit, it takes away all the signal current. Okay, this is only for biasing purposes. Okay. Here also 1.1 k is only for biasing purposes here. The current source I naught prime is this, this is I naught. So, the current source is obtained by a reference current, okay, which is generated through this 10 k and a diode, okay, connected transistor. So, it will be roughly the supply voltage divided by 11.4 k. That current gets reflected proportionately because different emitter resistances are used. Okay. This will be almost 5 times more than this, because this is 5 times higher than this. So, this current is going to be the same as this current here, okay. And these are emitter followers or unity gain stages that we have already discussed, okay, voltage follower, okay, with full local feedback. So, the output impedance is still lower, okay, and this is the feedback resistance RF that we have thought of, okay. So, 7 k 7 k, so 7 k divided by 590 plus 50, let us calculate that. 7 k is the RF divided by 590 plus 50 plus 1 over gm depending upon the operating current here. So, the plus 1 over gm. So, you will see that this is nearly equal to 640 plus, let us say this is going to be causing it to nearly become 700 ohms. So, that means this will be nearly equal to 10, which is given as the minimum gain of this structure. So, you see how quickly I arrive at the gain, okay, because it is a feedback amplifier. Gain is totally independent of the transistors that are used, as long as the GM of the transistors are high. I can make it 100, okay, or 400 by shorting these resistances respectively. External facility is there for gain adjustments. So, 100, 10 is when it is fully open, 100 when this is shorted, and 400 when these two are shorted. So, that is the kind of gain that you get, and the input impedance is typically, now the total resistance is let us say 700 plus 700, okay, that is about 1.4 k into beta is let us say 200. This is the beta. This is the typical beta of most of the bipolar transistors used in ICs. So, you get this as about 280 kilo ohms, right. So, 700 plus 700, okay, 1.4 k into 200, which is going to be 280 kilo ohms. Okay. You can see it is roughly 250 kilo ohms input resistance. You can therefore see how nicely this and how simply, okay, this IC can be analyzed for its performance. 200 megahertz bandwidth. So, that is the video range that it can cover this kind of gain, no frequency compensation needed, okay, because these are local feedback structures. That is why no frequency compensation is ever needed. And such structures are popular inside the IC, okay, so that they simply work. So now we will be covering the effect of gain bandwidth product and other non-idealities on the performance of the amplifier. So once again, this has to be thoroughly understood in selecting what op amp one should have for a given application. This is an important consideration. See, the, all these are considering that GB is infinity for this amplifier, that I can assume that the input voltage between the two terminals of the op amp is always going towards 0. That is the strategy that happened due to feedback, because the loop gain is very high. Now the loop gain is not very high. That means it has finite gain and finite bandwidth effect coming into picture. Okay. So what is the effect of that? So we have the gain, which is defined as A of this amplifier is going to be A naught divided by this. We had seen when we discussed the characteristic of the active element and its limited bandwidth. Maybe it has high gain, okay, but it has limited bandwidth, and other poles are made to appear, okay, at frequencies beyond or at gain bandwidth product or beyond gain bandwidth product. That means A naught into omega t. The second pole should only occur at that point. Then only they are good as feedback stages. This is what we have shown. So the gain bandwidth product, okay, should be same as the position of the second pole, that is Q equal to 1. That is the strategy. That means for most of the useful frequency range, it can be approximated as S by omega. This is important. So in its dynamic range of operation, what is important is the gain into bandwidth product in assessing its performance. So A can be approximated as GB by S. If such is the case, then the gain of this thing, any feedback amplifier structure, is the ideal gain. In this case, let us say K. And if you want K as the gain, that is 1 over G2, please remember that in the feedback network, right. So the bandwidth of the thing gets limited to GB by K. So that is how do you get this? This is always equal to ideal value divided by 1 plus 1 over the loop gain. What is the loop gain here? This is A, which is GB by S into K. So GB by K into GB into let us say 1 over K, right. So this is the 1 over K that is going to be fed back. Okay. So the you can therefore see that the bandwidth of this is gain bandwidth product divided by K. Okay. So this is the whole strategy of your feedback, right, amplifier design, 1 over loop gain. Okay. So GB by S into 1 over K. So 1 over K is what is fed back. Okay. So K becomes the gain of the structure. Okay. So you have seen this attenuator whose transfer function is 1 over K. Now let us consider that the amplifier has a gain of 1 unity, right. Then what happens is full feedback is given, okay, K is equal to 1. So the bandwidth is going to be K, okay, 1 plus S by GB. That is also called unity gain bandwidth. Okay. So K is equal to 1. Suppose we design, okay, an amplifier which is so-called inverting amplifier. Same thing, feedback is 1 over k, right, r, and let us say now k r. So, feedback is going to be 1 by 1 plus k, okay. So, gb by 1 plus k, that means feedback factor is going to be still determined by both these resistors, right. So, the bandwidth of this gets reduced by gb divided by 1 plus k when realizing a inverting gain of k, right. This is an inverting amplifier. So, that is minus. That means if k is equal to 1 here, right, the bandwidth is going to be minus 1 divided by 1 plus 2 s by gb. So, designing a non-inverting amplifier with gain of 2 results in the same bandwidth, which is gb by 2, as that of the inverting amplifier with minus 1. What is this puzzle, right? That means this can give the same bandwidth for a less gain than that, okay. That is because this is primarily not a voltage amplifier. You are just using it as a voltage amplifier by half. First, it is nothing but a what? Trans resistance amplifier, where I is the input and then it is converted to voltage, which is I into kr. That is how V naught is equal to minus I into kr. It is just that I is made equal to Vi by R by assuming that this is a short circuit. So, this is the voltage to current converter, okay. Because this is virtual ground here, this voltage gets converted to current here, and then that gets converted to voltage back. So, voltage to current conversion and current to voltage conversion is the step involved. So, basically this is a trans resistance amplifier. That is why the bandwidth is remaining same as that. And this is the source resistance maybe, which is converting the source voltage into a current, okay. And that is responsible for this kind of anomaly regarding the gain and the bandwidth. So, here please understand that, right, this is the non-ideality of the source which is making the bandwidth get reduced to a factor of gb by 2. If it is really a current source, then the bandwidth would have been the full bandwidth of gb, okay, because full voltage is fed back here, okay, if this is a current source. This is what is to be understood. This is what is not really understood when you call this as inverting voltage amplifier, okay. It is still a trans resistance amplifier. So, please understand this major distinction. So, this trans resistance amplifier can be used for a variety of applications today. We will see. Before we migrate over to other applications, let us see the effect of offset, input offset voltage. Input offset voltage and input bias current are the other effects that come into the performance of the amplifier. This is particularly so under the application of very low frequency applications like biomedical applications and geological applications, etc. In such amplifiers, okay, it is of very low frequency and the offset voltage drift with temperature mingles with the signal. And in such situation, we have to reduce the effect of this offset voltage. Already these are perfectly matched hopefully at the input, so that offset in the case of bipolar is as low as about a few millivolts. In the case of MOS, it may be tens of millivolts, okay. Whereas the bias current offset primarily exists in the bipolar as IB1 and IB2, the input pair bias currents, okay. and it is non-existent in the case of MOS. So, what is the effect of this input offset? As far as input offset voltage is concerned, it appears as a offset voltage here. So, it is going to be simply appearing as k times, if k is the gain, k times the input offset voltage here. So, higher the gain, higher is the offset here, limiting the voltage swing considerably if you are designing it for high gain. So, if offset is interfering with your signal, do not design it for high gain unless you compensate for this kind of offset at the input. How do you do it? The you can actually apply an opposite offset voltage at this input point. There are ICs available with offset compensation terminal being made available, where you can apply the suitable offset current or voltage at the input of the stage in order to make the output offset go to 0. Now, the bias current offset, how does it cause offset problems? So, the bias current, for example, in this particular case, let us say you have IB2 and this is IB1. This IB2 flows through a combination of R and K minus 1 into R. So, this resistance, if it is very high, then there is an offset voltage generated, which is IB2 into this. That can be compensated for by putting in series with the source, the actual source, a source resistance, which is equal to R parallel K minus 1 R. Of that value is put in order to compensate for the bias current that is flowing through that. Now, these are the strategies. So, for example, if you are using designing a buffer stage, normally you are connecting the output like this, but there might be a high impedance sensor at the input. So, how to compensate for the offset here? You just introduce a dummy resistance here, at the terminal of this and this output and input terminal here, where negative feedback is given, which will also carry the same current as the IB2, hopefully IB1 is equal to IB2. The IB1 minus IB2 is called delta IB offset. So, that is difficult to compensate, because you have to adjust these resistances so that it gets compensated. It is never done in practice. So, these are the non-idealities that we normally bother about. Effect of slew rate in amplifiers. Slew rate limits the power bandwidth of the amplifier. What is slew rate? Slew rate is the maximum rate at which output is capable of rising. This comes about because of the capacitive effect at the output. So, this is the maximum rate at which output is capable of rising. And our output, if for a sine wave input, let us say for testing it, we may apply a sine wave input. So, our output is VPO sin omega t, expected value for a sine wave input. However, delta V naught by delta t of this output voltage now is VPO into omega cos omega t. So, at the 0 crossover, the rate of rise is the highest, and if this rate of rise is not matched by your op amp, and if this exceeds the slew rate, so then you equate it to slew rate and find out the maximum frequency up to which it is capable of giving VP naught as the output. So, for example, just let us take TL081, which is having 13 volts per micro second as the slew rate. So, that, let's say we want it go up to 10 volts, okay, then the F max is going to be 13 into 10 to power minus plus 6 divided by 10 into 2 pi. So this comes out as 20 into, let's say, 3 or so, okay. So this comes out as, let's say this is 3, about 4, okay, and about 200 kilohertz, okay. So if you want to go up to a few megahertz, let's say 2 megahertz, in order to measure the bandwidth of the gain bandwidth product of the device, you might have to apply signal up to 2 to 3 megahertz. So what happens? 2 megahertz, it is only capable of giving, okay, a perfect sine wave only of 1 volt magnitude, okay. So that means 10 times less than this 10 volts that we have desired. So that means VPO equal to 10 volts, okay, can be generated, okay, generating a perfect sine wave at the output only for less than 200 kilohertz for the TL082. Okay, and if you use 741, it is going to be still just 1 volt even at 200 kilohertz, right. So you can't really use these things, okay, for the full swing at the output, and this is something that has not been thoroughly understood in the application of op amps, okay. It's an important last signal limitation of any op amp. Now these are the non-idealities that we have discussed: finite gain bandwidth product, finite slew rate, finite offset. Now let us come back to signal processing activities, which are the mathematical operations of actual electrical signal processing. Summing amplifier, you want to sum up, let us say, currents. So that is easily done by the trans resistance amplifier. At this node, it is appearing as a short circuit, okay. So it is current controlled, so it is a short circuit at the input. So any number of currents can be simply added at this point, okay, and they will be simply summation of these currents flowing through this resistance develop, okay, V naught is equal to minus II into R. That summing the current can be done by applying voltages and a series of resistances connected to this node, okay. So let us say VI1 has R by alpha 1, VI2 has R by alpha 2, Vin R by alpha n, all connected to R. Then what happens to these currents? This being at 0 volts, so these currents will be correspondingly alpha 1 VI1 by R, okay, alpha 2 VI2 by R, adding up, okay, the whole thing multiplied by R results in a summation operation, okay, m equal to 1 to n, okay, V in into alpha m, okay. This is a simple design of a summing amplifier. Now the back end of for example, this such a summing amplifier is one of the important components acting as a back end of a DAC, wherein we have all the inputs connected to a reference which is absolutely constant, and we have switches which will either connect this resistance to VR or 0. So what happens? These currents are either existing or not existing based on the position of the switch. S I 0 or 1 means these currents add or not add, okay. So and these currents are made binary weighted, R, so V R by R, R by 2, V R by R by 2, okay, V R by R by 4, V R by R by 8. So the it is going to be sigma of I equal to 0 to n minus 1 for n bit converter VR SI into 2 to power I. So the DAC 7821 TI, for example, is a 12-bit parallel multiplying DAC, which has as the backend, okay, 12 such resistances, okay, or it may be R2R ladder network, okay, with this kind of strategy. At the output, it is a trans resistance amplifier, okay, coming here to obtain an output which is the analog voltage, which is VR. Let us therefore look at this, how this appears. VR is the analog voltage, analog, it can be just VI, okay, into sigma, okay, SI 2 to the power I, which is the digital word. So, it is called a multiplying DAC, where VR is no longer a reference voltage, VR is one input voltage, okay, multiplied by a digital word, that is why it is called a multiplying DAC. It has a large number of uses in voltage control oscillator design, voltage control filter design, that digitally controlled filter, digitally controlled oscillator, okay, and digitally controlled amplifier designs, okay. And the future world is going to be digitally controlled front end or back end, okay, the analog front end and analog back end will be all digitally controlled because of the power of digital signal processor available today. Now, summing amplifier as voltage amplifier as summing amplifier, let us see. So, even a voltage amplifier, just as we used a trans resistance amplifier earlier, we can use a voltage amplifier as summing. This summing is done by a set of attenuating resistances connected in this manner, R by beta 1 to V 1 A, R by beta 2 to V and A, so on, right, and there is an R here. So, what happens here? From here to here, the gain of this stage has already been established by us as 1 plus R 2 over R 1 is 1 by G 1, G 1 is R 1 by R 1 plus R 2. So, V naught is equal to V I dash into 1 plus R 2 over R 1. So, what is the voltage V I dash here? It is nothing but, you can note that it is sigma of beta I V I A, okay, all this beta I V I A divided by sigma of beta I, okay, plus 1, because that is one has an input which is 0. So, that results in plus 1 R, that is R, that it is beta 0, beta 0 is equal to 1. So, this is what happens, the gain, the attenuation of this structure is sigma beta I into corresponding VIAs divided by sigma beta I plus 1, that into 1 plus R 2 over R 1. So, if you make your choice as R 2 over R 1, if it is chosen to be equal to sigma, okay, let us say 1 beta I, then this becomes equal to sigma beta I I equal to 1 to n. That is how you get this as a summing amplifier, but the coefficients are all positive here, okay, because it is a non-inverting amplifier. So, and this is one way to therefore combine those voltages which have to be added as positive coefficients at this point and those which have to be having negative coefficient as that trans impedance amplifier or trans resistance amplifier, and combining together we get this. Right. So, this is the earlier strategy, first strategy for trans resistance amplifier, which results in this minus beta that is alpha I V I B, okay, and this one plus sigma V I A beta I, okay, with now, okay, these conditions, okay, have to be satisfied that sigma of, let us see, m has to be same as n in order to exactly satisfy this. Otherwise, we have to connect m minus n inputs or n minus m inputs depending upon whether m minus n is positive or n minus m is positive, okay, to ground. That means we will make it 0. So that, okay, sigma of beta is same as sigma of alpha, okay. So that is the strategy as far as this is concerned. So now a special case of that is the difference amplifier, wherein the difference amplifier, okay, works with R, R by alpha, R, R by beta, alpha equal to beta, okay, just single input, okay, at positive point and single input at the inverting point. So we have V naught equal to VA into beta, okay, minus VB into alpha. Strictly speaking, it will be having a factor of 1 plus beta by 1 plus alpha, and when alpha is equal to beta, okay, this is what is valid, okay, it is going to be let us say this is slightly to be corrected, this is plus and this is minus, okay, and therefore it is going to be VA beta, okay, minus VB alpha, right. So alpha is equal to beta, this is going to be alpha into VA minus VB, right. So this is the strategy that actually speaking this is equal to, okay, VA into, okay, R by R plus R by beta. So it is beta divided by 1 plus beta and then that into 1 plus alpha minus, okay, VB into beta. This is the correct VB into alpha, sorry. Alpha. So this is the actual result. If alpha is equal to beta, you will see that this is VA into beta minus VB into alpha, okay, only then. So the differential gain is alpha, okay. So differential mode gain is alpha. Then when common voltage is applied, when VA is equal to VB equal to VA equal to VB equal to a common mode voltage, what will happen? Right, alpha if it is equal to beta, then only VA and VB get cancelled and no output occurs. So alpha is equal to beta only, okay, the common mode output is not amplified. Whereas if alpha and beta are different, then this is what happens, okay, and you will see that it is going to be governed by this ratio 1 minus beta by alpha. Beta is a ratio of resistors, alpha is a ratio of resistors. If the resistors have a tolerance, okay, R is R 1 plus or minus delta, delta is called the tolerance, then what happens? The ratio of resistors will have a worst case tolerance of only 2 delta, okay. So 1 plus delta divided by 1 minus delta, so that is a tolerance of 2 delta. And since two such ratios are involved as ratios, okay, beta and alpha, in deciding how close it is to 1, okay, then this will be 1 plus delta 2 delta by 1 minus 2 delta. So that means it will be 4 delta, and therefore the common mode gain is going to be equal to 4 delta divided by 2, because 1 plus alpha is there. So you will note that this is going to be equal to, okay, beta by alpha minus 1 plus beta by 1 plus alpha. So we have here 1 plus alpha beta minus, okay, beta plus alpha beta minus alpha beta divided by 1 plus alpha. So these get cancelled. Beta minus alpha, the difference, okay, with respect to 1 is what is the cause for the error. That is 4 delta. 4 delta divided by 1 plus alpha, okay, which is equal to 1. So you get it as 2 delta. So that is the common mode gain. So the common mode rejection ratio of this difference amplifier normally is alpha by 2 delta, primarily governed by the tolerance of the components. And therefore, you have to have good precision resistances, matched resistances used for this difference amplifier. Right. So how to improve the common mode rejection ratio? You therefore again start with the same strategy. There are two single ended amplifiers being used here. This is identical to this. So this is a symmetric structure put represented here. So converting it from single ended to differential. So you get a common ground here, and this ground is lifted and it forms a differential structure. This has been synthesized using nullator and narrator earlier in our lectures, and you will see that this has a common mode gain because this does not carry any current when this voltage is same as this voltage. There is no current in this because this is Vc, this is Vc. So and these two are Vc. So output is going to be at Vc and Vc. Only current will exist when this voltage is different from this voltage. That means when there is a differential voltage. So that differential voltage divided by 2R1 can be increased very much to boost up the differential mode gain of this structure. So this has a differential mode gain of 1 plus R2 over 2R2 over 2R1. Okay. So R1 plus R2 over R1 and a common mode gain of 1. So this is the beauty of this. This has a common mode gain of 1 and a differential mode gain of 1 plus R2 over R1. So you can boost up the common mode rejection ratio of this by increasing R2 over R1. And that is what is combined with the earlier difference amplifier in order to form a 3 amplifier version of instrumentation amplifier, which has become famous and is designed by almost every IC manufacturer. TI makes one such as INA103 with gain varying ability by changing R dash 1 to 100, high gain bandwidth product 100 megahertz at G of 1000, high CMRR 100 decibels, okay, using this kind of structure. Otherwise, the tolerance of these equal resistors will prevent it from going to such high values. And a 2 amplifier instrumentation amplifier has been given to you for evaluating its AD and AC. Please investigate this and see how well it compares with the previous version. Since it is using one less op amp, is it better to use this as against that? Now, strain gauge sensors, we will cover this as a sensor input to an instrumentation amplifier. How to design this structure, okay, will be the topic of discussion in the next lecture. So it is nothing but a bridge arrangement with strain gauges, okay, which is normally going to be used for measurement of force, velocity, strain, okay, etc., pressure. So this is an important instrumentation sensor arrangement. So let us see how instrumentation amplifier has to be designed coupled with this sensor and how to decide this MRR on what basis in the next class. So thank you very much. We have seen how a variety of applications using op-amp can be generated using a simple concept of current adding, voltage differencing, okay, and also seen how ICs can be generated starting from single-ended, single output structures to differential input, differential output structure. That is an important synthesis procedure. Okay, shall I conclude? The conclusion part has already been dealt with, right? Can I continue or is that time?
Yeah.
Okay. In conclusion, we can say that we have a strategy for converting any single-ended input, single-ended output IC to a corresponding differential input, differential output IC. And particularly for front ends, we have seen how a transistor structure, IC structure can be built starting from this concept of single ended input, single ended output, and putting a mirror image of that single ended input, single ended output, and lifting the common points correspondingly, okay, at the source ends by current sources, okay, at the drain end through resistors to voltage sources. Okay. So, whether they are bipolar or MOS, this strategy works. Now, further we used the basic concept of trans impedance and voltage amplifiers in summing and differencing and arriving at a general purpose op amp summer. You extended this concept to an instrumentation amplifier, again starting with single ended input and a single ended output, converting it to differential input, differential output, and improving the common mode rejection ratio of the difference amplifier.